A very good afternoon to all students. This is Professor Vishal Mhetre, working as Assistant Professor in Department of Electrical Engineering, Bharati Vidyapeeth, Team 2B University, College of Engineering, Pune. So here we are going to study about the AC-DC load flow analysis. So here mainly we will be focusing on the DC load flow analysis, its importance, advantages, step-by-step calculations, advantages and the various approaches that are required for solving the DC load flow analysis. So let's see the contents for this particular session. So importance of the power flow analysis, the significance of using the power flow analysis, the input and output parameters that are required for performing the load flow analysis. Now here the input and output parameters may vary from analysis to analysis. Like for load flow analysis, the parameters will be input and output parameters will be different. For transient stability analysis, for fault analysis, the inputs required are different. So the input and output may vary depending upon the type of analysis. Then we are also going to discuss the minimum data that is going to be requiring for performing any load flow analysis. So we don't require that much data in details as we require for other analysis, because we are going to study the load flow under the steady state condition that we will be discussing in the upcoming slides. The assumptions that are requiring for the DC load flow analysis, how the DC load flow analysis is advantageous than the AC load flow, the step-by-step load flow calculation, it is applicable for AC system, DC system, as well as hybrid AC-DC system. And the next, also we are going to study the AC-DC load flow methods, or we can call it as approaches. And at the end, if there are any doubts, you can just post it so that I can come back and answer to your questions. So let us start with the session. So the importance of the load flow analysis. Now here the basic fundamental properties or the parameters that we require for any load flow analysis are the voltage, current, power factor and the power, either real or it is also called as active power, and the reactive power flow at various points in the electric system. So in electric system, I mean it is power system, and various points means either it can be at the generator side, load side, at any particular bus or any transmission line. So these are the four important components that we consider for the load flow analysis. And important to note is that it is for normal condition. So normal condition itself means it is steady state condition, because the power flow analysis is applicable only for steady state condition. As we know that the power system is complex in nature, it becomes difficult for the real-time data, which is continuously changing, continuously fluctuating, to do the analysis part. So power flow analysis is applicable for any particular instant. At that particular instant, what are the parameters, and using those parameters we can do the analysis. So it is going to be useful in terms of, we can see in the next point, for scope of future expansion of the system. Suppose if there is an already existing system and some bays are kept to be used in upcoming future, transformer bays in particular substation. So if suppose I am planning to have a wind power plant nearby that substation, so the input I will be giving, whatever is the power generated, I will be giving to the nearby substation. So for that I need to have the planning. In that planning, what I have to do is how much is the power flow that is going to be flowing in terms of active and reactive power from the generators, that is the wind turbines, to the substation, whether those power, active and reactive power, are not active power but reactive power, whether it is in limit, how much it is taking or how much it is giving into the system. It has to be within limits, either way, otherwise it will cause the voltage instability. Then next important thing is about the operation. So this operation, whether it is performing smoothly or not, if suppose there are losses in the system, so we can identify by tracing the part. Suppose if there is one component, and if we do it in planning simulator, simulation softwares like ETAP or MyPower, then we can get to know that as the power is flowing component to component, after passing through the component, are there any losses occurring. If the losses are occurring, then we can check with the input parameters for that particular component. We can change the parameters as to reduce the number of losses and increase the power generation technique. So we can have this prior analysis done so that modifications can be done in the design. Next is in the economic scheduling. It economic scheduling means in terms of maximization and minimization of the things that are required for the input as well as output side, the minimum cost for the fuel or the raw materials, the calorific value should be more for the coal that is used in thermal power plants. The economic scheduling also means that during daytime and night time or throughout the time of the day, how much should be the power demand and how much should be the power supplied. So this all balance has to be created through this power flow analysis. So throughout the entire day, how much is the power flowing in the particular system? With that, we can have this economic scheduling. The next is exchange of power between utilities. Suppose there are two utilities or two grids, how much is the power flowing between those two grids? Reactive power or the two systems are in stable conditions, they are remaining intact with the other grid. So this is very important. If the system is operating under stable condition, for that is verified through this power flow analysis. So along with that power flow analysis, this power flow analysis is very beneficial for doing the analysis of transient stability, because for transient stability the inputs we are going to require from the power assist power flow analysis. Just note here that power flow analysis is required as an input for transient stability, not that power flow analysis is going to perform the transient stability entirely, because power flow analysis is applicable for steady state condition or the static condition, and dynamic or the transient stability is applicable for the dynamic condition, which transient is just after the occurrence of the fault, the system is going into instability, and after recovering the fault, system comes back to the normal condition. That part is the transient stability. And the contingency study are the extreme conditions that a power system can occur, that also inputs are required through the power flow analysis. So this creates a very important task for performing the load flow analysis, because it is going to be required as, we can call this as a fundamental analysis, because these analyses are required as input for further analysis. So let us see next the significance of power flow analysis. As we have discussed, the fundamental parameters, that is current, voltage, voltage angle, active power, reactive power, various buses operating in the power system under normal condition or the static condition. This we have already discussed. Now I want to focus here about the various buses. The various buses will be the PQ bus, that is the generator bus, PV bus, that is the load bus, and the third is about the slack bus. So here important thing to note is that at every bus, two parameters are known and two are unknown. So at PQ bus, P means active power, Q means reactive power. So active and reactive power is known, and the other two parameters has to be calculated. Likewise, for other buses, we will be discussing in the next slide. To plan for best operation and control of the existing system. So whatever is the operation and control of the existing system, how much should be the reactive power control? Now your reactive power control is very important, as it is going to contribute to the voltage instability. So if we have to know only the how much is active power flowing, so that the economic scheduling can be done, for that we can go for DC load flow analysis. But if we require active reactive voltage magnitude and angle, all those parameters, then we have to go for AC load flow analysis. So that is a major difference between AC and DC load flow analysis. Like if we have future expansion to keep pace with load growth, then we have to go for load flow analysis, that how much is the power being generated and whether that power is being whether demand is being completely satisfied by the generated power or not. Then in assigning new load, new generating station, new lines and new interconnections before they are installed. Now suppose if we are having the new generating stations or new loads which are connected to the existing system, then we need to have this in planning stage, that we have to do this simulation model in, as I've mentioned, in my power or ETAP softwares, where we can have the detailed study about all these new components that are being installed in terms of voltage, current, voltage angle, active and reactive power, whether all these are within the limits as per the IS standards. If they are not within the limits, then you have to do the certain changes in the system so that all these are brought back within the limits. So that is in the power stage. So due to this information, system losses are minimized and the check is provided on the system stability. So the system stable is very important, as we know that active power is dependent on the frequency and the reactive power is depending on the voltage. So this frequency and voltage should not get violated and it should be within limits. That is why this power flow analysis is very important. Now, the last important significance is that it provides pre-fault power system analysis to avoid system outage due to fault. Suppose if at every instant we are calculating the active power which is flowing in the system, and at particular instant we get to know that the power is suddenly decreasing, power flow is suddenly decreasing, then we can identify that there is certain changes in the system which has created this power flow to reduce, so that we can identify and implement it so that we can recover the system back to normal state and we can avoid the system going into the fault condition. Now let us see in the next slide that what are the input and output parameters for the load flow. Now you can see that the load flow, that is the heart of the system, and the inputs required are bus data. So here the bus data for every bus, depending on the type of bus, either the three types of bus, PQ bus, PQ PV bus and the load the slack bus, the what kind of data is required, either it can be in terms of voltage magnitude, voltage angle, all those data is given as bus data, either it can be real power or reactive power. Line data, here we can consider for resistance, reactance. I have also mentioned in next slides, we can see there the generator and load data, what kind of data we are going to require, that we are going to see. And on the output, what we are going to get on the output after performing the load flow, the voltage magnitude, voltage angle, real and reactive power, current flow and the power losses. So all these are very important to have the system in the stable condition and to avoid any problems which are created in the power system. So let us see the minimum data that we require for power flow analysis. First, let us see the bus data. So here we are going to mainly focus on the four things, that is the bus data, the transmission line data, the load and the transformers. So the bus data for PV bus. Now for PV bus, as I have mentioned that there are two known parameters and two unknown parameters. So here the real power and the voltage magnitude should be known, and the reactive power at the generation side and the angle should be unknown. So here what are the input parameters? The real power at the generation and demand. So your generator means generation means on the generation side, demand means will be on the load side. So the real power should be known at the real generator as well as the demand side, load side. Reactive power at the load side should be known, the voltage magnitude. Then for PQ bus, again the P and Q means the active and reactive power are known. The voltage magnitude and angle remains unknown. So your real power in terms of generator, generation and demands on the generator and demand should be different. Reactive power again on the generator and demand, that is on the generator side and the load side. For the slack bus, this is very important to note that for all slack bus is only one in particular system that we consider as a reference bus. If we don't consider this as a reference bus, the load flow analysis cannot be performed. So one slack bus has to be important. So for voltage magnitude, we are considering it as one per unit. Voltage angle specified to be zero. Real power and reactive power at the demand side should be known. Note that whatever are these input parameters are only limited to the load flow analysis. For any other analysis, the data required may be more, and the voltage magnitude which is specified one per unit, it may not be one per unit for other analysis. The next data which we are going to require for the line is for the transmission line, depending on the type, whether it is nominal T, nominal pi, equivalent T or equivalent pi, we require resistance, reactance only for having the line data. Now, if we see for nominal T and pi, for that nominal T and pi, we have capacitance. Now, that capacitance and reactance is different. Here we are talking only about the input data for resistance and reactance, which is important. Capacitance can be neglected as it is the shunt parameter. So here we require only the series parameter for power flow analysis. Next is the transformers. For transformers, we require only winding resistance on LV and HV side, leakage reactance on LV and HV side, magnetization reactance and iron loss admittance. So these, only these parameters are required. There are various other parameters for transformers where there are tap changing positions, the type of transformer, what is the temperature, operating temperature of the transformer, what is its operating voltage, all those other parameters, basic parameters which may require or not require for load flow analysis. But these are the necessary parameters we are discussing And the output parameters that we get at each node or branch, we can call it as bus. That will be voltage magnitude, voltage angle, real and reactive power, and the power losses. So let's see in the next, the assumptions that we are going to see for the DC load flow analysis. Now for AC load flow analysis that we have already covered in our previous lectures, that for AC load flow analysis, we have four methods basically. So first is about the Gauss-Seidel method, where Gauss-Seidel method acceleration factor is required, that which we call it as alpha. Its range is 1.6 to 1.8 to accelerate the rate of performing the iterations so that the convergent rate is fast to approach to the answer. So the second method is Newton-Raphson rectangular method, third method is Newton-Raphson polar method, and the fourth method is the fast decoupled load flow. So the Newton-Raphson method is the most widely method, as it requires less number of iterations and the calculations are much simpler as compared to other methods. So here we are focusing on the DC load flow. So here we have to do the certain assumptions, because the frequency parameter is absent in case of DC load flow, which is constant and which is not continuously changing. So here we can have the reactive power balance equations. We can ignore it because it is frequency dependent. So we can neglect those parameters. We can have only active power. Assuming all the voltage magnitude to be 1 per unit, as we have already mentioned, the line losses are neglected and the tap dependence in the transformer reactances are neglected. Now with the help of this, what we are going to do is we get a linear equations. So this, with these assumptions, we are going to cut down from the AC load flow, that gets converted into the linear equations that we can represent in the form of P equal to B dash into theta. So where P is the volt vector of the bus real injection, B dash becomes the bus susceptance matrix, theta is the vector of the bus voltage angles. So what we can have is, since this becomes a linear equation, which is simple, which is not depending on any fluctuating parameter, so we can easily calculate the value of theta, that is B dash inverse, by eliminating the need of iteration. So in one iteration, we can directly get the value of theta, that is the voltage angle. Please note here that B dash, the susceptance matrix, is obtained from the bus admittance matrix, which is the imaginary part of that bus admittance matrix. Now let us go to the step-by-step load flow calculation that is required for AC as well as DC system and hybrid system. So we need to specify the elements for the network components. So whatever are the network components, whether it is generator, load, bus, or transmission line, all the inputs should be given. Specify value, place value and constraints for load in the power system, that how much should be the limit on the lower side and limit on the higher side, that has to be specified. Same way, specifications and constraints on the generator, that is important. Then a mathematical model has to be developed to incorporate this, or incorporate the entire load flow with the input parameters in the particular system. We can take the help of any particular simulation software. So solve those equations for getting the voltage profile. The next step, we can go for power flow, solving the power flow equations and the losses in the power system. And then we can check for constraints for all this output that we have calculated. If they are within constraints, no doubt that will be the result for that particular iterations. But if some limits are getting violated, then we have to go to back to step one, where we need to change all the input data and then we can perform the iterations. So this is very important to know what should be the input parameters. Yes, the input parameters are also important to decide whether the limits or the result that we are getting are within limits or not. Then let us discuss the advantages of DC load flow over AC load flow. As we have mentioned, that the first thing is that for AC load flow equations, it is half the equations that are required for DC load flow. So we can say that it is 50% equations only we are solving for DC load flow, because the assumptions that we have considered. So one thing is to note down here, the DC load flow is non-iterative because of the linear equations. We can solve it only in one iteration. But for AC load flow, if we can say that it is non-linear equations because of the presence of frequency parameters. So there may be sine trigonometric components which are there to solve those AC load flow, and that is why that becomes non-linear equations, and that is why it has more number of iterations. So we can compare here AC as well as DC load flow by saying that AC load flow requires more number of iteration as it is non-linear, and DC load flow is linear, it requires only one iteration. So here B dash matrix is state independent provided the system topology does not change, it need only be factored once. So B dash matrix, the bus impedance matrix, unless and until all the parameters are not changed, the bus impedance matrix or this P dash susceptance matrix remains constant for the system. But if some parameters are changed to limit the or to get the system back into the normal limit apart from violations, then this B dash matrix need to be updated if any data is changed in the system. Therefore, one with the help of these assumptions, one can say that the DC load flow is 10 times faster than the regular load flow, that is the AC load flow, and the subsequent result, that is theta, which is obtained, we can modify P with the help of forward and backward substitution. So these are the major advantages of DC over AC load flow. Now let us see the advantages and disadvantages of DC load flow. So the DC load flow can be applied for the approximation of unknown voltage that can be used as initial values, because we can say that unknown voltages, whatever are there, we have to find, that can be calculated. But in the initial condition, all the value of voltages we are considering at 1 per unit and the angle is 0 for having the Newton-Raphson or decoupled load flow equation calculation. Only limitation or the disadvantage of this method is that we can calculate only the megawatt flow, that is the active power flow, on the transmission line and the transformers. It gives no identification on the voltage magnitude or the reactive power flow. So it is only used to have the active power. Suppose if we should know how much is the power which is going to be flowing in the entire system, there if we don't consider the stability, then we can only go for this DC load flow analysis. But where we are considering in a situation where we need to have the calculation along with the stability of the system, then there itself we need to go with AC load flow. Now let us see the various load flow methods that are required for hybrid AC DC system. So here, incorporation of DC system gives rise to modified load flow problem for hybrid. So DC, the parameters are different because it is linear, and the AC, that is non-linear. So we have to synchronize these two terms together. Ultimately, we can solve the AC system and get the result. So for that, we have three basic approaches. One is unified approach, the sequential approach, and the eliminated approach. So here, the order is just shuffled here. So let us first discuss about the sequential approach. So the sequential approach is the first conventional approach where AC and DC load flow equations are solved separately. So there, whatever the AC load flow at which buses that are separated out, DC load flow at which buses they are connected, that are separated out, and then we are calculating this AC and DC load flow equation separately. Then the DC load flow equations, we are converting it with the help of voltage dependent loads in terms of voltage dependent loads through the converter side as well as inverter side. We are giving it as AC injected quantities, and finally the method is solved for AC load flow because the DC system is converted into AC system. The sequential approach is easy to implement because it is separately solved for AC as well as DC system. Only the thing is, the conversion problems occurs in specific situation where the equations which are we have obtained for DC system, it might give some difficulty for converting them to AC system in few cases, not in more cases. The next important approach is about the unified approach. Here, what we are doing, the DC equations, we are incorporating it in the AC matrix itself. So suppose if there are 4 to 5 number of rows and columns for AC load flow, the 2 or 3 rows and columns will be added for the DC load flow in the same matrix itself, so that it becomes a hybrid matrix of AC as well as DC. So the solution vector is extended with DC variable. So the unified approach is what we are doing actually here, is whatever is the DC and AC, we are combining it in the one matrix itself, and then matrix we are converting into equations, and then we are approaching to the solutions including the DC variables. So the unified method is better computing, and the convergence is much more suitable as compared to the sequential method. That is the reason why it is used in most industrial AC-DC power system for load flow problem. The drawback is the complexity of the program. Rather, we get it, the results are obtained in a very good manner, but for executing those things, the inputs and the synchronizing of DC with AC, it becomes difficult, but the results are much better. So the difference between here, I would like to mention the difference between the sequential and unified approach. In sequential approach, we are solving the two methods AC and DC separately and then combining the result. But in unified approach, what we are doing, we are combining both the input variables AC and DC in one platform, that is the matrix, and then we are solving it together to obtain the result. That is the major difference between the sequential approach and the unified approach. The last method that we have is the eliminated method. So whatever are the difficulties, it is almost similar to unified method. Whatever were the drawback, like complexity of the program, difficult to combine with the development, so that problems are being overcome by this eliminate method. So what we are doing, that is why it is called eliminated method. So here I would like to focus that eliminated variables of AC DC load flow are entirely different as compared to unified method. That is one point. Second point is that the real and reactive power which is consumed by the converter that we are considering at as voltage dependent loads. This point should be highlighted because it is very important to have the comparison between eliminated and unified approach. So the DC equations are solved analytically or numerically, and the DC variables are completely eliminated from the load flow equations. Now, completely eliminated means what we are converting into AC injected quantities. That is why that is eliminated. It is not that we are directly eliminating the DC variables. So with the help of this advanced, or we can say the stretched method of unified approach, the advantages are AC and DC parts of the load flow can be handled separately. So we can have a combined effect of sequential and unified approach that becomes the hybrid result, that is the eliminated method. In few steps we are following the sequential method, in few we are following for unified method. This simplifies the realization and modification of the program, that becomes reduces the complexity as compared to unified method. It is easy to handle changeover or control modes due to variables which are going to cause violations in the limit. So that's it for this lecture. Thank you for you all for watching this lecture. In case of any doubt, you can just post your comment. I will get back to you. In the next lecture, what we are going to study is we are going to study the different DC load flow methods, the converter, inverter, and the DC link variables, the steps that we are going to follow, algorithm, and the solved numericals, so that it becomes easy for you to get your concepts cleared that how this DC load flow analysis is incorporated. Thank you.